My name is Adam of Grayskull. When good is threatened by the power of Eternia,
hello YouTube, and welcome to a new toy review. This time let's take a look at my new Adventures of He-Man action figure collection. The new Adventures of He-Man was the follow-up series to the original He-Man cartoon, and it took the whole story into kind of like a Star Wars-y futuristic world.
I was summoned to the future by the last of mankind to defend them in their hour of need.
That really appealed to me as a child, and I really liked it. I remember even thinking that the New Adventures show was better than the original He-Man. I know this is sort of like sacrilegious thing to say nowadays, but as a 9-year-old, I kind of liked it better. Also, the figures were much more available for me. Growing up in Europe, I'm not saying these things were in every toy store, but they were more easy to find than the original figures. So also in this sense, they were much closer to me. Rewatching the cartoon with my current standards, it sort of turns out to be not as great as I remembered. Sure, it's an okay cartoon. I kind of even like the animation, but when it comes to story, I think it's very weak. But then again, the original He-Man was not as strong in the story department either. So the new story is basically He-Man gets kidnapped into the future and becomes this great warrior for some other people, and Skeletor for some reason follows him into the future, which I never really understood why he did that, because he could have stayed and just ruled Eternia like he always wanted to. But anyway, it's just a cartoon, so it doesn't have to be that deep. But I'm here to talk about the toys, and I have to tell you that these toys are really great, kind of obscure. I don't think that many people know them, especially they are not as well known as the original figures, but they are some very good quality action figures, and they are some of my favorites. As you can see, this line has a few very cool vehicles too. I have these two spaceships and this walker thingy, which is called a Terror Pod. And I have a few figures that I can show you. I will go through each figures individually and show the vehicles individually too. But before we start with that, I want to show you this very cool power sword that came out in this line too. Now, the power sword, all I remember is that it had an insanely cool commercial featuring kind of like a holographic Skeletor thingy attacking a boy who was playing with the power sword. And I have to tell you that that frightened me a lot as a child. I was really afraid of asking for this toy because the commercial kind of made me think that if I do, then Skeletor Ghost will attack me or something. The sword has some very nifty features. It takes 4 AA batteries here in the battery compartment, and it has light and sound action. And it makes these firing sounds, which are really cool. But what's really cool about it is that it even makes sound just when you move it, like this. So you can imitate fighting with it, and it kind of makes a sound as if it was a real blade hitting something metallic. I think that is insanely cool, and I have never seen any 80s or early 90s toys use this kind of technology, because this kind of technology is kind of well known right now. We have a lot of things that make sounds when you move them certain kind of way. I think it's like done with gyroscopes or something, but this must have been a very special feature back then, to have a toy that actually makes sounds as you swish it around. I think this is the coolest feature of this toy. So I know the lighting effects didn't really show because my light is on, but I will just switch it off and show it to you guys. Okay, so let's start with the He-Man figures of this line. As I said, this is probably my absolute favorite He-Man figure ever. That's because it's been my holy grail. I was really looking all over for this figure in every toy store when I was a kid, but of course I could never find it. But I don't know, it just really appealed to me. But this was not the first New Adventures He-Man figure that came out. This was actually, I think, the second or the third one. The first one was this. They came out with this new He-Man figure, which has a lot of different things going on. First of all, the sword sort of looks like it's from Star Wars. It really looks like a lightsaber with this yellow blade, and I really like the yellow shield too, because it just looks like it's some kind of force field that you can carry with you as a shield. And I thought that this concept was really, really cool at that time. But the figure is not as big and not as bulky as the old He-Man figures were. In fact, here he is next to the original He-Man, and you can see that the two action figures are very, very different. So I'm guessing the guys who produced these figures thought that they were not selling as good as the old figures did, because they were not as big and not as bulky. So probably because of that, they came out with a new He-Man figure that resembled the old look. It even has the old action feature, where you can just, well, it's not really working that well anymore, but the waist turning punch action that he has. So I'm guessing that's why they are so similar, but I really like this look actually. I like the fact that he's like a big barbarian put into this futuristic kind of like a force field kind of armor, and with this futuristic lightsaber kind of blade. So maybe that's the reason why he's one of my absolute favorite action figures. I really like the articulation they gave for this figure, and I'm also really happy that they got rid of the rubber bands that are holding the legs together on the original figure. That was really a pain in the butt when the rubber band got torn and the figure became useless and lost its leg. So that's not happening here, because there's no rubber band in the figures. However, you still have to be very careful with them, because as you can see, the legs can still snap off quite easily, and I have like three or four figures like this from this line that had the legs just broken off. And if it happens, then you actually don't really have any ways to fix it. It's not like you can, you know, you have the method to fix the rubber band with these figures, because you can just buy O-rings, and you know, there are lots of tutorials on the internet about how to do that. In this case, you sadly you can't fix it. You need to buy a new figure, and that really sucks. So you really have to be careful with them. These are old toys, even though they have really nice articulation, they are not perfect. And the other thing that keeps happening is that the handle of the swords keeps breaking off. It's really, really hard to find a sword in this line that has the handle intact. Actually, it's already really hard to find the swords for the figure, but a sword with an intact sword grip is very rare. Most figures have featured this kind of articulation. The head is articulated, it can rotate, arms can rotate, waist usually is articulated and can rotate. They even, most figures have articulated knees, and not just that, but even rotating knees. So that's really cool. I think that's sort of unique when it comes to early 90s action figures. The legs can bend, and they can do the splits about this much. So very nice articulation indeed. They usually, all of them, have a very nice and unique action feature too. As I mentioned, I really like the yellow vest that he has. It's removable, of course, and you can store his sword in the back. And also he comes with this yellow He-Man shield, which just attaches like this. It's not really staying on that well, but it stays on quite okay. So, and I think this version of He-Man was called Thunder Punch He-Man. Him next to the original He-Man, you can already see the differences. The original He-Man, however, comes with more armor, and I really like this feature too. I like the fact that he comes with a removable helmet, which kind of looks like a football helmet, but I think it's still really cool. He also comes with a green bladed sword, power sword, and it is also plagued by that problem that the handles break off really easily. So what you see here is actually a handle I made it for myself, because the original handle was broken off. He also has a green shield, which has a little bit different way of connecting to his arm, but it's basically the very similar shield to the other one. And his face sculpt is also kind of similar. I forgot to show you the face sculpt of the other figure. What's interesting about these figures for me is that in the animation you see He-Man with a ponytail, but none of these figures actually have the ponytail on. So no ponytail on either. But I think the face sculpt is okay. I like these additional design elements, for example these arm guards that he has, his belt. Looks cool. He's got the same kind of articulation as the other figure, sort of, so legs have a really wide range of movements and they can do the splits too. Knees can bend and also rotate. But when it comes to the arm articulation, he's a little bit different. As you can see, he's doing this slashing action also with his other arm. So you cannot really pose them that well. But I will show you why that is. His armor is also removable. It comes to two pieces. And beneath that he's almost naked, except for this golden, I don't know, chest guard thingy that he's wearing. In the cartoon you usually see him like this. I don't think he ever wears his armor. I don't remember ever seeing him in armor in the cartoon. But I don't know why that is, because I think he looks really cool in this golden armor that he has. It's very futuristic looking and very nice. On the back, you can store his sword like this. Unfortunately, there's no space where you could store his shield too, so you have to have that on his arm. Now, all of these figures have an action feature, and of course He-Man has one too. If you look at him from behind, you can kind of see this sort of crevice that he has on the back, and your finger fits here quite well. It's because you have to use that. Put your finger there. Make him turn his waist around like this, and then he will do this kind of sword strike action that you see here. And he will also raise his shield as blo like he's blocking. But because the shield is not really staying on that in his hand that well, it tends to fall off as you do this, like you see. This is the third and last He-Man figure that I have in this line, and I saved him for last because he's my least favorite one. That's mostly because he's got this very, very weird chest joint that allows him to do this, which I don't really know why they included this, because it really looks stupid and sort of disturbing to see him in this position. I think it's supposed to be some kind of uppercut punch action, but it just looks really, really stupid, and I really don't like it. The other thing that I don't like about this figure is the face sculpt. He looks like a gargoyle or some kind of angry bulldog. I don't know. I'm just not a big fan of this. But this is the only He-Man figure in this line that actually has the ponytails, so he is a little bit more cartoon accurate than the others. But still, this is a very weird action figure, and I'm not a big fan of him. It just looks very, very weird. Now let's check out Skeletor. I think this is the first Skeletor figure in the line. This is definitely the way he looked at the beginning of the cartoon series. He's also supposed to have a purple cape, which unfortunately I don't have with him. This is another sort of accessory that is quite difficult to find nowadays on these figures. But he also comes with a helmet, which is removable. But he looks really freaky without it. I don't really like to have him without his helmet. Also, if you look at him, you will see that he's got a lot of freaky detailing going on. Like, his whole spine is exposed here, and it's got all this machinery attached to it, which is, I'm guessing, it's making him stronger or something. In the mini cartoons that come with the figure, you can see in one story that Skeletor injures himself as he arrives in the future, so maybe he needs these kind of machines to stay alive. And also on the back of his head, you can kind of see this sort of spider-like machinery going on, which is really freaky. But also, this is the kind of detailing that I love about these figures. And I think they look very, very cool like that. You see all those tubes running up and down his thighs too. And I'm guessing this is also some sort of machinery that's fused with his body. I think that's really freaky and really cool. Also, his armor looks to be fused on his chest. So I like his helmet too. I think it looks cool. And it definitely makes him look a little bit better. Now, he also has an action feature, and it's kind of the same as He-Man's. You can put your finger into this crevice here that makes you that helps you rotate his waist. And as you do that, he will raise his staff like this. And this is also a feature that I really, really like. I think it looks very cool. It looks very dynamic, and well, it's not every day that a figure can even hold a two-handed weapon properly, not to mention to include that two-handed weapon into a really cool-looking action feature. So I really like this figure because of that. I think it's very unique. Articulation is same as the first He-Man I showed, only the arms are, of course, a little bit hindered because of the action feature, but the legs have the same kind of articulation. I like the design. I like how they kept the original foot design of Skeletor with this kind of weird-looking feet that he had. Of course, they kept the original colors too, with the purple and the light blue. So I think it's a very cool Skeletor figure. I wish I had the cape too. I think the staff looks very nice too. You can see the skull on it and some nice detailing. So definitely a really nice looking Skeletor. The other Skeletor I have in this line is this. I think he was called the Discs of Doom Skeletor or something like that. I'm missing one of his weapons, which was sort of like a throwing disc that he could throw. His action feature is that you can make his arm bend back, and it's spring-loaded, so it would spring forward, and this way he could throw his throwing axe or throwing disc, which I don't have, unfortunately. He also comes with a shield, which is also skeleton themed. It looks sort of like a skull, like a screaming skull. I think that's cool, and they still managed to make it look futuristic with all the tubes and wiring and stuff. I think it's very nice. His armor is different, and everything you see here that's white can actually glow in the dark. So that's also a really nice and frightening feature. He's got bigger feet, and the whole figure is a bit more chunkier. I think he's the figure that is supposed to be the enemy of this He-Man, because they look quite nice together. Now, one thing that I'm also missing on this figure, unfortunately, is the hair. This figure had black hair put here, the back of his head, and I don't know why it's missing. I bought this figure used, so probably someone must have torn it off. But other than that, he looks quite well. He also has some freaky detailing going on the top of his head with all these veins. It looks very frightening. I like his armor that also looks sort of like a skeleton. He has this weird waist joint. I'm guessing that's because of his action feature, I don't know. His arm, unfortunately, cannot move. It only moves back and forth and up a little, but that's it. The other arm moves well, but it's also a little bit hindered by this shoulder guard, so it cannot rotate all the way around. The legs have the same articulation as I showed before. But Skeletor was not really the only main villain in this show. He was actually playing second fiddle next to this guy, who's called Flog. So let's take a look at Flog himself. Flog is a mutant. He's the leader of the evil mutants, and Skeletor is sort of pretending to be his buddy throughout the whole cartoon and using him and his mutants for his own schemes. And Flog is really stupid and he believes everything usually, and he partners up with Skeletor, but he's the main boss of the mutants, so that kind of makes Skeletor his lackey too. The figure himself looks very nice. He also comes with a helmet, and if you remove the helmet, you end up with this, which I think looks a little bit funny and not scary or terrifying at all. It kind of reminds me of a snail or something, but the helmet definitely helps. I think the helmet makes him look that much more menacing, sort of Darth Vader-like. Without the helmet, I think he looks rather funny. He has this red attire on, and articulation is about the same as all the other figures, except that his action feature is that his arm will rotate out and then back. And he needs this for his whipping action, because he comes with this weapon, which is a whip, basically. And there's a string, and there's supposed to be a little silver thing attached to it, which I don't have, so I just put this on. It serves sort of the same purpose. And I have to tell you that this action feature is absolutely amazing. You just rotate his body and he will whip his whip. And I think this looks absolutely fantastic, because it's just everywhere and it looks really nice. I love this action feature and I love this accessory. I think they really outdone themselves with this, and to think that this is just such a simple feature but looks very cool, I think it's genius. I love this action figure because of that. So if you're looking to pick Flog up, you definitely have to make sure that you have this part. Even if you don't have the little thing attached to it, you can easily fix it, but please look for this part, because this makes this figure absolutely very unique with this action feature, and it looks awesome. Another favorite mutant of mine is this guy. His name in the show was Slushhead, but he's also called Calamar on some of the European toy boxes. And I forgot to mention that Flog is also called Brack in some European countries. I don't know why some of these figures have two names. So he's also one of my favorite figures, mainly because he's so unique looking and so cool. He was not really cool in the cartoon, he was a really big doofus, but I think his figure looks amazingly cool. This is his action feature, nothing more, unfortunately. He comes with this very well-designed gun that he can actually hold as a gun, but he can also hold it as some kind of axe, and that makes a lot of sense when you think about his action feature, which is basically a chopping action. But if you want, you can also give him a gun and make him shoot. I think that's very, very clever toy design, and I really love it. Unfortunately, he can only hold it in his right hand. His left hand is open, and he has these flipper thingies on. I love how his skin is designed, and it's all frog-looking, and has all these crevasses on. Also his legs are, also his feet have fins like his hands. He comes with a backpack with this tentacle thingies. You can kind of rotate them, but unfortunately it's not bendy wires, so you cannot really bend them anyhow that you want. This figure also have a, has a very interesting face design, because the dome that he has covering his face is filled with water, or some kind of water-like material. I'm not really sure it's actually water, but I have to admit that this is also a really, really cool feature that you don't really see many action figures using it. Some of the mutants from the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle lines had the option of you putting water into the figure, like Mutagen Man did, but this one, it's actually not removable, so you cannot take the water out. But seeing how old this figure is, I'm really amazed that this is actually still intact. So I think it's another very well done toy design, that these things didn't break, and the fluid did not discolor or anything else. It still looks amazingly well. So he's definitely one of my favorite bad guys in this line, and also one of my favorite action figures, because he's just so unique. I love how he's designed. He's a very cool toy. Next up is Lizor, who really is just your standard lizard looking bad guy. Nothing more, nothing less. But I still think he's a very cool action figure, and I also really love his design. I love the way his tunic is designed, because it's sort of organic looking. You can kind of tell that he's from maybe a tribe of lizard men. I don't have his backpack, unfortunately, but on his back you can also see that it's very organically designed, and I think that's very clever. But he also uses some technology. He obviously has his gun, which is very threatening, and he comes with a helmet too, which is removable. So you can see his lizard face without the helmet, but the helmet makes him look like a real soldier for Skeletor. His action feature is sort of the same as you saw with Slushhead, only the other way around. He's raising up his weapon instead of chopping down, which is your classic gun draw action, so I'm guessing that's why he comes with a gun. Very generic looking lizard man figure here, but I still think it's working very well. It definitely works well with the other, with the design of the other mutants, and even if you're not really into collecting He-Man, I think this lizard man would make a very good bad guy for any other collection. Next comes Optic. Optic is basically an eyeball that has a body. I think he's one of the freakiest action figures that I own, and that's because of that he's probably one of my favorites too. He also comes with a nice looking gun, but his whole body is robotic looking, and he's got wires running everywhere, so you can kind of tell that he's just an eye who designed a body for himself and now has this robotic body. On the back you can see this thingy that you can turn. If you turn it, it will make the eye turn left and right. Unfortunately he cannot look up, but his eyeball can turn, which is his action feature actually. I have to admit, he reminds me very much of Triclops, but I think his action feature is way cooler than Triclops's is, and I think he's also way cooler looking, having a robotic body, and he's just very, very futuristic and very cool. His other action feature is the same as Lizar's. He can draw his gun like that. almost done. Only one bad guy left. And his name is actually Butthead. Now, Butthead is probably one of my least favorite bad guys in this line. I think he's sort of generic and bland. And his action feature is not that big of a deal, too. He has this hunched position all the time, even though you can move his knees just like the other figures, but somehow you cannot really pose him in any other position than this. And he has this protector thingy over his face, and on the back he has a red button, and if you press it, his head shoots up. Again, I don't really think that's really impressive. I have to admit, I don't like his head sculpt at all. I think he's very weird looking and not that interesting. I think he looks better with this folded down, but still, I don't think it's such a cool figure as the others were. Now, the bad guys have a few vehicles in this line and also a few playsets, which unfortunately I don't have any of them, but I have a few vehicles, so let's take a look at them. This is called a shuttle pod. It's basically just a little spaceship. You can have one figure sitting in there. You have an opening cockpit. You can close it. And you kind of can rotate these little wings on the sides. I think it's cool. Also, it has an opening compartment here in the back. And it comes with a few extra weapons for your figures. So, you can have this, which I don't really know what this is. You can have this, which I still don't really know what this is. You have this shovel thingy. And you also have a little gun. I think that's the most useful part of this collection, but still, it's nice to have some extra weapons, seeing how most of these figures are always missing the accessories, so that's cool. Probably the most interesting part of the shuttle pod is that it can actually fit on top of the terror pod. As you can see, they are designed to fit together, and this way you can have two figures on the terror pod. You can have one sitting here, one sitting in the cockpit of the shuttle pod, and now you have the terror pod. The terror pod has got to be one of the coolest vehicles in this line, definitely. You have this huge walker. You can have two figures sitting inside. You can actually make two vehicles merge together and transform it into something very freaky, very nice, very cool. So this is really one of the most precious part of my collection. I'm really happy to have this. And it can be a little bit wobbly with the shuttle pod on top, but you have plenty of options to pose the legs, so you can make it stand properly. And I really think that it is amazing looking like this. Now, the main feature of the Terror Claw, of course, is to have figures in the claw. And as you can see, it can actually hold even the more heavy figures quite well. It's not toppling over or anything. Of course, you have to set the legs the proper way, but the feature actually works. You can sort of control the arm from here. It does not work that well. You can't really do that much with it, but you can kind of wiggle it around. And it is also articulated here. And of course, the mouth can be opening and closing. Unfortunately, you cannot open or close the mouth with this little operator thingy. You can only rotate the arm around, and that's kind of it. The Terror Claw can house some other figures in there, and also in the back with it has two pegs that other figures can step on. It has a little bit of paint application, so it kind of looks like it's rusted. On the first blink you might think that this is sun damage, but it's actually not. It is part of the paint application of the figure. I think it looks rather nice. The legs look very, very cool, and they also have these wheels. That's because the whole thing can transform, and you can have it in this kneeling position where it can actually roll, because he has a wheel here, he has a wheel on the foot, so it actually rolls pretty well, even on carpet. It is a little bit front heavy because of the claw, especially if you have a figure sitting in, but I think if you put another figure here, it will kind of balance it, and it's a nice little feature. He also has a third mode, which is like a standing attack mode. You can see that you can stand it up like this, and you will have this little window for your figures that you can put in here. You have to kind of put them into a kneeling position like this, and even then this sort of joystick thing is sort of in the way. But you can kind of see what they were going for with this, to have like an armored walker for the figure that they can operate like this. Also, you can open this door here, and it can serve as a trapdoor or something, or just make it a little bit more easy for you to remove the figures if you put them inside. So, a very versatile toy with lots of different functions. You don't really get this from anything else in any other toy line, so I think it's a really unique and cool looking toy. I just wish they used this vehicle a little bit more in the cartoon, because you can see it in the opening of every episode, but I don't really remember seeing them use it actually in that many episodes, which is a pity, because this could have been really a signature weapon for the bad guys that none of the other shows had anything similar to, so it would have been nice to see it a little bit more. And now for the good guys. This guy here is Tuskador, who is sort of the New Adventures version of Snotspout, except that he has a very different action feature, but he's also an elephant-looking dude. I really like these weird heroes in this line. I just wish they would have shown up in the cartoon a little bit more. I think most of them don't show up in the first, like, 30 episodes of the cartoon, which is sort of a bummer, because I would have loved to see some more of these guys. His action feature is that he has a lever here, and if you pull it, his tusks will open and close. So he can sort of capture bad guys with his tusks, and that's really it. He comes with this white gun, and he doesn't have any other action feature actually, so that's all he has. His arms can rotate, and he has the same sort of leg articulation that all the other figures had. Comes with this blue boots blue pants and futuristic looking mammoth armor that he's wearing. I think he's a very cool guy. Would have loved to see some more of him in the cartoon. But unfortunately he was not featured that often. Another one of my favorites is Captain Flipshot. He's a really cool looking fly guy. He has his blue armor, helmet and jetpack thingy, which is of course removable. You can also close his wings, which I don't really know why is a possibility, but as you can see this peg enters here, but it doesn't really stay in that well. So I'm guessing it's just for you to be able to close the wings, I'm not sure. He comes with this rocket launcher thingy on his arm, which is also removable. If you remove his helmet, you can see that his face sculpt is actually rather nice. He's a good looking guy. He also has this little switch on his arm, which I'm absolutely not sure what purpose it serves. I don't know why that's there. I don't even see anything change if I switch it on and off. And his left arm has this spring-loaded action that I think is supposed to make him do this. Like, you can turn him around, hold him at the arm, and he will do this flipping motion. I think that's the flip shot that he got his name from. I'm not really sure. I think if you watch his toy commercial, the kids are doing this with him. But it's not really working that well, and I'm afraid I'm going to break something if I force it too much. It might actually work better without the backpack, because this way the figure is a little bit more lighter. So yeah, I think this is his action feature. This guy here is Spinwit, or his European name is, I think, Tornado. He was also one of my holy grails growing up. I really wanted to get this figure, but I don't really know why, because he has a very weird paint color scheme going on. His pink pants and orange arms sort of look weird, but for some reason I was obsessed with this figure. I don't know why. I thought his helmet looked really cool. For some reason he reminded me of Robocop, I think. I'm not sure, but I think he's also sort of a rare figure. I'm definitely sure that there's another version of him, which is even more rare. I don't have that one, I have never even seen it in person. And also he came with two wing thingies that could attach to his arms, which are also very hard to find, and also it is very hard to find a complete figure that has all those wings too. His action feature is that you can turn his waist around until you hear a click, right about now. I'm guessing you shouldn't turn it any further than that, and then there's a little button that you can press right here, and if you press it, he will do the spinning motion. He is sort of this toy line's version of Cyclonus. They have a very similar action feature. I think it would look better if I had his wings, but I still think it looks very nice. I love this feature, actually. His arms are a little bit loose, but they all have the articulation to be extended like this. You can also turn them around. His helmet unfortunately is not removable, but as I mentioned, I really like the design of it. You can kind of see some mechanic elements on his clothing too, as most of the others figure have. And as I mentioned, he's wearing pink pants. And brown boots. He's one of my favorite figures, and I still can't tell you why, but he is. And I saved Artilla for last, mainly because I think he is the ugliest action figure of this line, if not the ugliest action figure that I have ever owned. I really have no love for this character. I think he looked a little bit better in the cartoon. He looked a little bit different, at least his face was different. I'm not even sure if this was supposed to be his face or what, because it's just that ugly looking. I'm not even sure if he's supposed to be a robot. I think in the show he sort of had a human face with some little cybernetic attachments to it. He has a button, and if you press it, his face will jump out, which makes him look very, very freaky, and I just don't like this guy. I really don't. He has this, like, red rockets, I think, on the top of his head. This has got to be one of the freakiest action features ever. I'm guessing he is this show's version of Roboto from the old Masters of the Universe, but they really messed him up. They really made him look freakish. He also has several weapons. One is this, that you can just fold out of his arm, like that. He doesn't even have proper hands, it's just sculpted on somewhere here, but there's no hand on the other side. His other hand is also sort of freaky. He has this rocket, and if you move his hand, it will shoot out like this. Probably stab you in the eye if you're not careful enough. It really shoots hard, so the spring is very strong in it. And, well, he's a robot. His leg articulation is a bit different from the others. You can also sort of move him the same, but he's a little bit more rigid. I don't know. He always has to stand kind of hunched. You can't really extend his legs any more than this. So he's definitely not a favorite figure of mine. And I can't even believe he's one of the good guys because he's so ugly looking. And last but not least, I have here the Astro Sub, which is the spaceship for the good guys. And I bought this thing unopened in a box, like about a half a year ago. And it's in very, very good condition because most of these tend to get yellow, and luckily this one is in perfect condition. However, I was very unlucky because the stickers didn't stick anymore, so I had to use some glue to make them stick. I guess they were old, and also the plastic got a little bit old, so as I was putting the whole thing together, the plastic just snapped. So I had to use some glue here too, to fix it. Which is a bummer, but that's what I have right now. The other thing that really bummed me out is when I realized that I cannot fit my favorite He-Man figure inside. Because he can't fit. You can't close the... You can't close the door on him, so unfortunately, he will not pilot the Astro Sub. So the Astro Sub is actually a spaceship that can turn into a submarine, and the transformation I feel is a little bit forced. I don't even really see the need why a spaceship should be turning into an astro, into a submarine, but still, it's not a bad feature. You have this cool-looking drawing on the box, and at the top of the box explains you the different kind of modes that you can play with this thing. This is the spaceship mode. You can hold it here at the handle, which unfortunately was broken on mine, and you see this sort of trigger here in the bottom, and that triggers the rocket right here, and so he can actually drop the rocket if you pull the trigger. Yeah, it's not always working that well, but that's the function there. So you can hold it like this, you can put your other hand there, and you can make it fly around like that. It looks cool. It sort of has an X-wing vibe to it, definitely, but I think this whole series is sort of kind of ripping off Star Wars, so I'm not that surprised by this fact. Actually, I kind of like it. To turn it into a submarine, you have to close these golden guns. You have to fold the wings up like that. You can see that you have some spare bombs on each wing. I think you have to fold these wings down, and you have to have your scoop up like this. So now this is supposed to be a submarine, and you have the feature that you can actually look into the scope right here. I don't know if you can see it on camera. I'm trying to turn it towards the light. Yeah, you can see my lamp there. So in real life, you can actually see quite well with the scope, but it's not really coming off well on the camera. So you can sort of run around looking in the scope and see out here. That's the big action feature of the toy. I think either as a spaceship or a submarine, it's impressive looking. I really love having it in my collection. I think it's a cool toy, and I definitely needed something to balance up the power that the bad guys have with the Terror Claw. So I'm really happy to have this. Now there were two play sets for this line too, the Spaceship Eternia play set, which is just basically a bigger spaceship that turns into a base or something, and the Planet Nordor playset, which was the home planet of the bad guys. I don't have them. They usually go for a lot of money, and I just never had the opportunity to get one. But I think if you like space toys, and if you like toys that really remind you of Star Wars, I think this line is a really great choice. Now, the Masters of the Universe Classics line also came out with a new Adventures He-Man figure, which is also one of my favorite He-Man figures. As you can see, he has the same setup as the original He-Man in this line, as in he has the same kind of chest armor, same kind of shield. Unfortunately, it's not as see-through, but the same color and the same type of sword. The main difference is that he actually has the ponytail from the cartoon, so he's more cartoon accurate, But other than that, he's basically the same figure. He has the same type of belt, same type of boots, same arm guard. I really love how this figure came out. He's very, very true to the original source material. And what's really cool is that you actually have the option to have him in the original armor too. He comes with two heads, one without the helmet and one with the helmet. But you can add the armor after, and this will make him look just like the original, as you can see. And I think it's pretty amazing. I love the detailing that went in to the armor. I love the added details, but still it's very true to the original. You can kind of see the same clock that it has, the same kind of tube that goes across here. So it's very, very true. Also, the helmet is very like the original, and I just love the way they did this. Because these figures are so special for me, I'm really happy to have this updated modern version of the classics figure here in my collection. I think he looks amazing. Also, they made an updated new version of some other figures. They made a classics version of Flipshot, which also looks very cool. I also have that figure, I just don't have it with me right now. And they also made a Masters of the Universe Classics version of Optic, which I don't have, but maybe I will buy because Optic is also one of my favorites. So I'm really happy to have these figures. I think they look amazing, even together, but still, I'm really grateful for the new adventures, He-Man. Thank you for watching this rather long review. Stay tuned for more and take care.